Rube Goldberg. It is a complicated device with multiple different steps and chain reactions to accomplish a simple task. So these are the rules. So we would definitely like your students, your teams, to build this, to work on this. There are stark differences between the two. So for middle school, our goal is to, both of them, is to launch a 2-inch vinyl kickball. So that's just our goal. So you're building a device to try to launch a vinyl kickball. For middle school, the goal is to launch it for the furthest distance in the least amount of time. High school, same thing. You're launching the 2-inch vinyl kickball, but you're launching it in the greatest amount of time and closest to the target. So it's for accuracy for high school, because obviously you know what Rube Goldberg devices is more difficult to create something that takes longer versus something that takes real short time. So that's kind of that graduation. Middle school is a little easier. High school is a little harder. For the size of the actual device is different for both middle school and high school. The middle school device is a larger footprint, and for high school, it's a smaller footprint. So obviously building a device to fit in a smaller, to do the same task or to do a different task or a more difficult task is more challenging. So that's kind of the whole idea of having these two set. And then also for middle school, we're talking about three sequential and different types of dependent actions. For high school, it's four. I'm open to changing that. I know Rube Goldberg devices can do 20, 50 different actions. I think that's a little bit much because you're talking about a large contraption. So I'm thinking of administrative and how kids can bring their projects. So we're trying to get them on a bus, try to get them in a car versus these gigantic Rube Goldberg devices where they actually have to set up on the day of and take some hours to do it. So that's why I'm thinking of three and four different dependent separate actions. And then the same thing with the different energy categories. High school, you have to do three of the four, and then middle school, you do two of the three. So that's the main differences between those. So this is just a configuration for the middle school. So for the middle school, as you can see from the previous slide, is for distance. So you want to go as far as you can within the landing zone. So if it lands outside of the landing zone, basically it's just like the mousetrap car that we've had before. Like for distance, if it goes out of the track, that's where we mark it. So if it lands outside of the landing zone, that's where we'll mark the distance. So for some of you, this might harken the day back to the trebuchet. So if you pull a string, you push a button, that starts a chain reaction, and then at the end of that chain reaction, you have this ball that's inside your device that launches it out.
I had a question about the scoring.
Yes.
Is it where the ball lands, or is it where it ends?
It's where it lands. So for high school, instead of distance, it's for accuracy. So we have a specific target that we have 3 meters away from the device launch zone, and it has to land as close as you can. Kids can come up with whatever design that they want to come up with. And the other thing is I kept safety to a maximum so that in order for them to launch their device, they have to stand outside of each of the safety zones. So they can't just stand right next to the device, pull a string or push a button because we don't know if it's going to explode or if they have fluids and pressure. So we want them to be outside of the area. And in the rules, I put in goggles.
So question from UC Santa Cruz, is the final distance determined by where it first lands or where it stops moving?
Where it first lands.
Another question from UC Davis. The goal is greatest amount of distance to shortest amount of time, correct?
For middle school. For high school, it is the closest distance in the greatest amount of time. So we want the greatest amount of time. So we're giving them still a time limit, which is 60 seconds. No matter if it's middle school or high school, they have to do it. Middle school, they have to do in the least amount of time. So if they can do it in 5 seconds, 10 seconds, that's better than doing it in 30 or 40 seconds. For high school, we want to try to get them to max out that 60 seconds. So if they can do it in 59 seconds, then that's a better score. And then we're taking that divided by how close they are to the actual target.
UC Davis has a lot of great questions. Is there a height limit?
Of the device? Yes, it's a rectangular prism. So it's in the rules, which is rule number 2.
The 60 seconds and the pressurized fluids, it doesn't feel like they go together. So you're saying from the time the ball is released, in a minute, it's gone through the entire Rube Goldberg, and the ball is flying, and then however long it takes for the ball to land, that's another time frame?
No. So the hacky sack is not what initially starts the chain reaction. The hacky sack, the 2-inch vinyl ball, is the last thing that is being launched. So it's not going, so the 2-inch vinyl ball is not going to be the start of the chain reaction. So it's not going to go through the whole 2 or 3 separate chain reaction. It's basically at the end. So basically the device, when we set up, the device has to be able to store the 2-inch vinyl kickball as the last thing that's being done in the sequential action. So for example, if you want to do first thing, you just have maybe a tennis ball. So you have a tennis ball up here, you pull something, it rolls down a ramp, maybe that tennis ball hits maybe some dominoes. The dominoes fall, that hits something else, maybe a pulley or something, then that pulls on something else, then maybe the last thing you have is a spring, because the spring launches something. So the vinyl kickball is the very last thing. So it does not go through the device. It's everything else launches that last thing.
Can you give an example of how they use pressurized fluid?
So the question was, how do you use pressurized fluids? Or you could use a syringe, maybe with some tubing. That's just an idea. I mean, for this, since it's project-based, since we want to do next-gen science standards, we want to give kids the opportunity. So I know as MESA advisors and teachers and center staff, we always want to try to coach our kids. I rather see this as, here are specifications, and I'll go over next, which is the engineering design process. This is so, so crucial in what we want you as MESA advisors to impart. And this helps you become better teachers, and especially if you're a science teacher, this is what you have to do, and this is what we have to do in order to be more comfortable doing that. So the first thing is, what is the restraints? What is the problem that we're trying to figure out? So these are the constraints. These are what we have to do. Then they have to figure out, do some research, imagining, coming up with brainstorming. What ideas can we use? Let me go online. Let me go see some Rube Goldberg devices in action. Let me see, you know, how things are done. Let me take physics. Let me take Newton's law in consideration. Then they go into the planning phase. You know, what materials do I need? How do I build it? Maybe they'll do a isometric drawing of their device so that they know what the front side looks like, the top side, the other side looks like. Then they're actually going to create and test it. And then, obviously, that may not work. You know, engineers go through this cycle 5, 10, 20, 30 times because that first rocket that SpaceX launched, what happened to it? Yeah, and that was millions of dollars that they spent on that. So this engineering design process is not us telling kids, oh, here's some ideas for pressurized fluids. Here's some ideas that you can use for gravity. Let them do the research, the imagining piece, let them do the planning piece, and you're just the guide in giving them this piece so that you can help them go through this whole cycle. So the first thing they're going to build doesn't work. Second they build, maybe a little more successful. Third thing they build would be a little better. And then maybe fourth and fifth, they get it right. Or it gets better to that. And that's what engineers do in the real world, and that's what we're trying to teach students. Yes.
So I'm still not clear on the time. Is the time starting when you first initiate the device?
Yes, to the time it launches the kickball. So we'll have a timer there. So once we say 3, 2, 1, go, the timer will start, whatever. And then there'll be another person there to see the device launch the kickball. So it'll be the time from the initiation device to the time it launches the kickball.
Just to clarify, you said that the initiation launch is not part of the
correct.
Three.
Absolutely.
Three. Okay.
Yeah. Because then, you know, then it's really not 3 or 4 independent. It's actually less than that. So I want them to think more about the device itself, and then they can figure out how they want to initiate the device. All right? Any other questions?
Yes. Will there be a limited budget for all materials used, just like we have one for the arm?
Nope. So there is no, and I know access has always been a conversation that we have, equity and all of that. I do not want to implement an itemized budget sheet that we've dealt with the prosthetic arm. It's been a nightmare for all of us. The only way that we can do a cost is to do that, and that would just take so much time. But if that's something you guys want to do so that we can make sure that everyone is on the same page, if you've seen with the windmill that we've done years ago, there were teams that got things fabricated, and they spent a lot of hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of dollars because they had access to a fabrication lab at their school versus a school somewhere, you know, else that does not have that. We're open to this. Again, I'm not mirrored and stuck to these rules. These are just rules for us to start the conversation. If something doesn't work, let me know. I'll give you my email address at the very end. We'll finalize this for the actual replacement of the mousetrap car for next year.
That was the question from Imperial Valley. We have one now from UC Davis. Is the time from start to land or start to launch? I think you addressed
it's
that.
It's start to launch is the actual device. So we're focusing on the device and not the speed of the actual. So if we're going to calculate the speed, if you want to, we can. So we can calculate the speed by the time of the launch of the kickball to where it lands. So we can actually calculate that speed. But I'm just looking at the device itself. I want to see how long kids can prolong for high school, because you want a longer time. And then for middle school, we want to try to get it done as quickly as possible. So if they can do it fast, just the device itself, versus focusing on the actual kickball.
From the Ukiah Field Station, in the future, would the presenter consider using golf balls or some other spherical object that can be launched more consistently?
I'm open to that. I'm just thinking of safety reasons. So something hard as a golf ball probably will not work for us. But if we wanted to use a golf ball, then it probably we would have to require it to roll on the ground. Again, these are just ideas. If we want, I just think the hacky sack is light. It doesn't really hit. I mean, if it hits you, I mean, you won't get a big welt on your head, a safety reasons. So I rather have. So that's why I didn't go with a tennis ball. A tennis ball probably has a lot more when you're forced, when the impact. And the launch itself. So that's why I went with the hacky sack. If we want to try something else, I'm open to that.
From UC Davis, can we use drawing software?
Drawing software. So for this year, for the demonstration pilot event, there is nothing required, no drawing, no engineering design notebook, anything. But obviously, if they want to use that to go through the engineering design process, if they have AutoCAD, if they have other software, by all means, engineers need to do that first. So you're talking about building bridges. Do engineers just go out and start building bridges? Absolutely not, because people will die if you don't have plans, if you don't have a drawing of it, if you don't pre-test it in a lab, if you don't have a model of that beforehand. So absolutely, if they want to do that, but it's not required for this. So the rules are on the MESA statewide website, as all of you should have that, mesa.uclp.edu. Teach Engineering has some awesome, awesome lesson plans. So definitely go there. They have some great Rube Goldberg type of activities. And then there's some teacher resources at the Rube Goldberg contest. Lastly, this is my email address. So again, I welcome anyone and everyone's ideas, suggestions. Email them to me, what we can change. But again, these are it for this demonstration and pilot. And then for next year, we'll incorporate your ideas, and then we'll roll that out for 2017 and 2018.